Welcome to our broadcast. The Hollywood studio system collapsed after World War II. It made way for a new breed of independent filmmakers. They included, and think about this list, Martin Scorsese, Brian De Palma, Steve Spielberg, George Lucas, and especially Francis Ford Coppola. With the Godfather trilogy and Apocalypse Now, Coppola developed his epic yet very personal style within the major studios. And then he started his own company, Zoetrope, and even bought his own movie studio in the early 1980s. Welcome.
Thank you.
What was it like growing up in your household? And when did all of this sort of sense of feeding this now legendary Coppola imagination begin?
It was, I think, very magical childhood. In fact, for years, I thought my father, when I was little, was a magician. And it was only when I was a little older that I realized he was a musician.
Yeah.
But I very much remember the sound of the flute as a little kid, because being a symphony musician, he practiced, and prepared and warmed up. And I always used to hear this kind of beautiful sound. And to this day, when I hear a flute, it brings back my father to me. I lost him a couple of years ago. And I had an older brother who was extremely important to me, 5 years older, and always leading me into exciting new areas, literature when I was young. And it was just a very magical family, I think. And we had the Italian-American influence. My dad always, although my grandparents and my parents really loved America as the Italian-America does, they always made me feel as though our Italian culture was something to be proud of. And we ate pizza when no one ate pizza, and we had wine at the table.
They used to call you science.
Yes.
Why was that?
Well, I was a boy scientist. I loved more than anything technology and learning about the lives of the scientists. And I always had in my life, I do now, a little shop where I would build things and try to make inventions. And ultimately, I was always involved in the radio club or the science club, or I could make little bombs that would blow up a remote when I was little. And I just loved science and puppets. And I think ultimately, and it's because puppets are sort of scientific a little bit, you have a string and the mouth opens. And that ultimately led me to participate in the lighting of the school plays.
Yeah. And the love of movies?
I always loved movies. My brother used to take me. My first impression of films were the Korda films. The Thief of Baghdad, The Man Who Could Work Miracles. To this day, I adore the work of Alexander Korda and that unique style that they had. But, we went to the movies. I always went with my brother. But I first became involved in theater before really thinking that I might be a film director. From being the person who did the lights and worked on the tech crews of high school shows or what have you, ultimately I became, in my college career, kind of interested in directing, mainly because I was always up on a ladder hanging a light and watching the professor direct the actors. And after a while, I got the confidence that I could do it, and I started to do that.
Other than Alexander Korda, who influenced you? I mean, who was shaping the way you thought about film and the way you thought about what you wanted to do with your life?
Well, first, I have to say that it was the theater and the work of Tennessee Williams and Elia Kazan. Being a drama student of the 50s, these were the magical names. Of course, Marlon Brando. I really loved and responded as many people to Tennessee Williams plays, and read them very young. And in fact, I did a production of Streetcar Named Desire when I was 17 in college. I became a little bit of the boy wonder of Hofstra College. I, in fact, started the drama club that's still there, the one that I did. And I even tried to start a Hofstra Cinema Workshop, which in those days, funny how it is now, but I think two students came. But I had a very...
Did you merge something, though? I mean, was it something you created, something called the Spectrum, or you merged
the Spectrum? Yeah, what it was is there were two big organizations. That one was the drama organization, one was the musical comedy organization, which I was... And I discovered that the funding for the plays was really coming from the student activities fee. And what I did basically was become president of both of them at the same time and merge them together and issue a decree that only students could direct the major productions, of course. And that's how I got my chance.
Was being at Hofstra shaping influence?
Totally. Hofstra was a wonderful place. I had wonderful teachers, some of whom are gone, Professor Beckerman, who later went to Columbia. And, you know, this was precedental to let young students take over actual, normally in a school, the faculty directs the shows, the big shows. And NAFTRA had a beautiful theater, still does. And, you know, partly my own political maneuvering, but also, I think, under a proud eye of the faculty, we took on some enormous production as kids and musicals, original musicals. And it was, I think, the encouragement of you know, a young artist needs to know that they can even do it in order to aspire to do things. And I got that at Hofstra.
Well, I read a story about you going to the movie and seeing Sergei Eisenstein's 10 Days That Shook the World based on the John Reed book, and that somehow you changed your outlook.
Well, I wanted to go to the Yale Drama School, and I really wanted to be a playwright in those days. And it was, it takes years to make a writer. And certainly my efforts as a playwright, although I had a playwriting scholarship at Hofstra, I just was, I just didn't feel that I had any talent. And talent was a big commodity in my family. I mean, my father was, very tough on whether you had the gift of talent or not. And at any rate, I didn't feel I had any writing talent, although I would write every day and try. And so I sort of became a director in school almost by default, because I seemed to have ability to get the show on and to get the sets built. But one afternoon around 4 o'clock on a fall day, the little theater, I saw a poster that said they were gonna show this Eisenstein film. I had never heard really of Eisenstein. And I saw 10 Days That Shook the World with three other people in this room. And I was so impressed. I'd never seen, of course, it's a silent film. I'd never seen film that worked like that. And it was on that day that I said I wanted to be a film director and not a theater person. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because Eisenstein himself, who was a theater designer in his autobiography, refers to the fact that on a certain day, equally, he said the cart broke and the driver fell into cinema. Yeah. So he had a kind of, and for a while, Eisenstein became a little bit of a guiding influence, because I felt it was very good that I get a good theater basis in theater craft and acting, and then go on to movies. And to this day, for young people, I would very much recommend that they work in the one-act play form and with actors and in theater before they get involved in the movies. And a lot of directors don't have really the experience with working with actors that they might get if they
start. Because they go to film school and then go directly to working in the movies and never hit a theater.
So even in film school, it's amazing. Really, all over the country, there could be a film department and a theater department, and the students don't mix. They don't know each other. The directing students in the film department will never go and do one-act plays, which is the best thing a film director could do. To first work with the performances and the content without the burden or the obligation of the camera, you know, and then having done some one-act plays and really have a sense of how you help an actor get to what you want, then go on and start to see what's the best way to put a camera to it.
But how did you get from being influenced by Sergei Eisenstein to working for Roger Corman, who everybody knows is the king of the B movies, yet at the same time has touched the lives of a lot of people?
Well, I went to the UCLA Film School in 1960, and the first thing they told you at UCLA was, well, 10% of you are going to even stay in this program, much less
become movie makers.
Yeah, and it was very much what we felt was, our wildest hopes were that we could maybe make an industrial film or whatever kind of film, a U.S. Agency film or something. But the film feature film directors didn't seem, they were older and they didn't. No one from a film school had ever directed a feature film. So, it wasn't as it is now, where young people have the model of Steven Spielberg and they want to go in his footsteps. It seemed like a closed thing. And of course, having a lot of theater experience, I was dying to work with a camera, and I was I was a writer, I was a writer who had put in a lot of years trying to be a writer, whether I thought I had talent or not. At least I did it a lot, and there was an ad for Roger Corman, and we all knew that one thing about Roger is he made a lot of films, and if you would work cheap, you could work in films and be around a set. And I hadn't even been on a movie set in my life. So I remember that the day I was waiting for the callback of whether I could go in for the interview was also the day that the phone company was going to cut off my phone because I didn't have any money to pay the bill. And I was just sitting there saying, please don't cut off the phone.
Because I'll never get a job.
Yeah, because, and then sure enough, I did get the call and they did cut off the phone about an hour later. And I went, was interviewed, and I got this job, which was a funny job. Roger's assistant interviewed me, and that led to a relationship where I sort of became his assistant because I would do everything. I would wash his car. I would move the sod of his lawn. I would rewrite scripts. I'd be the dialogue director on the Vincent Price movie, and I would edit all night. In fact, I even used to slump over the moviola and even be sure that when he came in at 9, there I was with my arm over the moviola.
And she would take care of me.
Yeah, and he would see that I had, been there all night, which I had.
Yeah. What led to the first film?
Well, Roger in his closet had, sort of these rolls of old film, they weren't even little trims. It was whole cans of films that he had left over. And there was a perfect tone recorder, which was a sort of movie sound recorder. And I mean, equipment to a young film student is such a scarce and difficult thing to come by, especially in those days before video. That I heard that Roger was going to go to Europe and make a film called The Young Racers. And he asked me, he said, Francis, well, you're at UCLA. Do you know any young guy who could be a sound mixer? I said, I can. And I went home and I read the manual. And sure enough, Roger brought me to Europe as the sound man for a film he was making. And I did that. And it was also second unit photographer shooting the Grand Prix races. This is a wonderful period for a guy 21, and then miraculously, just before we left, I won the first prize in the Samuel Goldwyn Writing Award, which had never been given to a film script. So I had $2,000, which was the prize, and I bought myself an Alfa Romeo sports car. That's what they cost.
Yeah.
And I mean,
times have changed.
I was 21. I was working on a movie around a set, and I knew that Roger always made a second film wherever he went because he would have the company pay for the first one. It was AIP. Mm-hmm. And since everyone was there and the equipment was there, he'd always do one on his own to, kind of average out the
cost. A moonlighting film.
Yeah, but he had to go back to do The Raven, a movie that became The Raven with a wonderful film that he directed with Vincent Price and I think Boris Karloff and Peter Lorre. Really a nice little film. And so I said to him, let me make the second film. And stayed up all night and wrote a script and got Roger to give me $20,000 to go off to Ireland, which was an English-speaking country, so that I could get actors and stuff and make my first film. And that's how I did it.
Did you remain close as you became famous and had your own studio?
Yeah, well, Roger was appeared inside as in the cast of Godfather 2. He was on the Senate Investigating Committee. Yeah. Roger loves to act. And Roger told me once, says, Francis, if you stay thin, keep your hair, and have a lot of money, you'll be young forever.
Yeah.
He's pretty
harder to do than to say.
Most people say, well, I have two of those.
Talk about Apocalypse Now first, because I've got that here. And it is so central, it seems to me, to your life. And if you look at Godfather and then Apocalypse Now, look back on it and tell me what your hopes were and your expectations. I mean, your wife has made a documentary that a lot of people thought was an incredibly good documentary. Gene Siskel thought it was the best movie he'd seen that year. It was an extraordinary story in itself.
Well, the origins of Apocalypse really, in a way, don't begin with me. I had become at a very young age, a director of big studio feature film. Probably I was the first film student to get that opportunity. And I was actually making feature films at Warner Brothers, and around me began to collect through an association with a young USC student who was a kid and who one thing led to another and became a kind of assistant at first. And
this is George Lucas.
George Lucas, and I recognized his intelligence and know-how right away, and he became sort of my friend. I didn't have a friend, like a little bit like a younger brother. And so George, it turned out, I didn't even know this when I had met him, but George was really an extraordinary USC student, had won every student award. He was really a heavyweight even in his own world there. And a lot of young people gathered around or were George's friends. And since George was now working for me at that time and with me, they sort of would come in to get inside the studio. And our office was filled with people who later became the famous directors of that period.
And they included?
Well, specifically John Milius, but right. It was John Milius.
He was also a writer. Yeah.
And well, he was a writer at Carol Ballard, Caleb Deschanel, Brian De Palma right. was around. And of course, you know, it was like we were the Trojan horse. We were in the studio and we could get in through the gate. And so they were around and we were always talking. And the idea, I think even Carol Ballard had always been the one to say that he would like to do the classic Heart of Darkness, the Joseph Conrad novel, which, of course, Wells had wanted to do and prepared but never made. And also around was John Milius, who was beginning. You know, he's a great storyteller, Milius, and he was telling about these young guys, surfers, who came back from Vietnam, and the vision of Vietnam was different than any war. I mean, it was guys on LSD looking at the rockets in the air, and of course, the use of drugs as an element in that war, and these extraordinary anecdotes that were coming back, guys surfing on the breaks in Vietnam. And this collection of impressions and stories he had heard, he wanted to work up into a piece that originally I thought was called A Psychedelic Soldier. And the idea was that George was going to direct it and John was going to write it. And Carol Ballard was in there also talking about Heart of Darkness and stuff. And at one point, not my idea, but at one point, Milius and George decided that they would somewhat borrow the idea of the boat going up the river to attach all these vignettes that John was talking about to something that he would write. And I was interested in getting George the chance to direct a feature film, and in fact, I succeeded, and George made a film called THX 1138, which was his first film. And the idea was that George would make, as his second film, a script that John would write, and at that time, I was able to wangle from Warner Brothers some funds to give all these young people money so they could do it, including George. And John Milius began to write a screenplay, which finally he called Apocalypse Now. And it was done, and it was a very good script, we thought, and George was going to do it. And then we had a lot of, you know, setbacks, and the administration at Warner Brothers sort of dumped us. I think they saw THX 1138, which was so far out in their minds that it wasn't what they thought they wanted to get into. And ultimately, all these scripts and stuff, because I had the success with The Godfather, Warner Brothers made me buy back, which is sort of, I mean, that's outrageous. When have you ever heard of a studio head that when he leaves has to pay for all the projects in a development? Well, that's what they did to me. And I ended up with all these scripts. And I went to George and I said, well, George, let's do Apocalypse Now. And by that time, George was already going on and doing other things. And I think he was even, I forget what he was doing. I don't know whether he was writing Star Wars, but he had already made Graffiti. But at any rate, George couldn't do it. And then I went to John Milius, who directed a fabulous picture, I thought, his first picture, Dillinger.
Dillinger, right.
And really one of his best pictures as a director. And I certainly was impressed with John. And I said, why don't you do Apocalypse Now?
His kind of movie to do.
Yeah. And he, they wanted to do it, you know, in 16 millimeter and, you know, maybe do it in much more in a newsreel style, which was George's concept. And I wanted to do something else. I was writing The Conversation. I wanted to do The Conversation.
And the film later starring Gene Hackman.
Years later, I got to do.
Right.
So also another thing was happening is my entrepreneurial spirit, which had been honed at Hofstra College, was in action. And I realized that we could basically, we always wanted to be independent and control our own destiny with film and against the idea of the big company that would kind of just use us and tell us what to do. So I developed with some of my friends the idea that we would go around the world and we would make a film that we would finance by getting each country to put up an amount of money as partners in advance. In other words, Italy would put up so much money, France, et cetera, and we would get the money by getting distribution advances, and therefore we would own the picture. And I knew we could do this, but the question is, John Milius wasn't able to do Apocalypse, turned it down, or said, I can't do it. So it sort of fell to me, and I was the head of the company, and I believed that I could finance it this unique way, which I thought might be a precedent that we could maybe go on and continue to do that. And by doing that, we would basically build a real company that really could make movies and give new people chances and own the movies. So at one point I decided, well, you know, I always liked the idea of this idea, and I liked the script, and that I would do it myself. But I had different ideas about how to do it than George and even John. Number one, I very much wanted to make it even more like Heart of Darkness. And in fact, if anything, make it be a kind of transliteration of Heart of Darkness to the Vietnam setting, which was not really what they wanted to do. The end of the original Milius script was quite different. It didn't really end in the same way as, or without any of the kind of philosophy of Heart of Darkness, but rather ended in a giant battle in which the Willard character joins with Kurtz, and together they hold off the big John Wayne battle scene. And that didn't really feel right to me. But also, I didn't want to make it in 16 millimeter. My idea was to do the opposite, to go there and make it in IMAX.
Yes, right.
and to kind of make it in 3D, make it in quadraphonic sound, to kind of be able to go in and rather than a documentary, to make it in the opposite of that. And so what happened was I did basically put up, again, my own money, which was in the form of my house that, by that time, I had come into possession.
And this is after, the extraordinary thing about this is after the enormous success of Godfather.
Right, well, Godfather, and then really what was catching lightning in a bottle, Godfather 2, and The Conversation. So right. I'd won all these Oscars. Right. I had won 5 Oscars.
You were the director of the decade.
Right, and here I am. No one had ever touched the Vietnam subject. No one had ever made a feature film, other than John Wayne, who had made the Green right. Berets. And I was going to take up all the money I had made, which I had, among other things, bought the great Inglenook estate, which right. was the queen of the Napa Valley. And I put it all on the line to borrow the money, which, along with the advances from all the European countries, I was going to go off to the Philippines and make this film. But
let me interrupt you. It, as we look at this now, I mean, before I even go to the clip and before I hear a lot more about this, was it the worst decision of your life?
Oh, not at all. Not at all. I wouldn't say that at all. I think it was a great decision. I mean, when else is it the time to go on an adventure when you're, kind of was, what was I, 34 years old?
Yeah.
I don't think it was a bad decision at all.
But you had all this going for you, and some have said that it marked something, that it was a turning point in your life, in your career,
well,
and that you rolled the dice.
Yeah, but that was
and you didn't.
That was the thing to say. I mean, as we know, very often the story is written before the story happens. And yeah. all I had to do was to go off to the jungle in this condition and ask for a modicum of privacy, which is let me try to make this film. And already, as you know, the reports were coming back that, oh, it was a disaster, primarily because no one knew. And it was just a mystery. And the story would to be that the guy who had made The Godfather and who, despite all odds, made a second Godfather that people thought was as good as the first and made The Conversation, was out there somehow failing, because that would be more interesting than if I were out there succeeding.
But it was a controversial project for all the reasons you just said. I mean, you didn't want to do it in the beginning. And then, Harvey Keitel was hired on. And then he was fired by you over whatever differences or whatever happened.
No differences. It was not at all. Harvey's a great actor. It was purely that as I saw the material, the kind of actor Harvey is. Harvey's like a magnetic guy in that school of acting, which is the focus is on Harvey.
Right.
And the character was a kind of witness who just was passive looking at this stuff. And that was basically in my mind. Also, Harvey was uncomfortable in the jungle. And I just, I had everything riding on it, and I just had to make a call still admiring Harvey, you know, that there
it's
was
not a question of Harvey. It's just a question of the kinds of things that happened to you in this film.
But this is what a director does. A director makes decisions, and that's why you want to have someone who's not afraid to make a decision, you know? And I guess I felt that, number one, also movies were at that time starting not just Apocalypse, but we were to see the trend that movies were going to cost more money than a movie had cost in the past. It was in those days you could make The Conversation cost under $2 million.
Right.
But no one had ever heard of a $20 or a $30 million movie. I mean, Cleopatra was...
What did The Godfather cost?
The first Godfather cost $6.5 million, and the second Godfather cost $14 million. Mm. But that index was continuing to go, had nothing to do with Apocalypse. Apocalypse, being an ambitious production, was going to be another milestone on the index of cost. Today, they talk in terms of films costing $80 million. This is a phenomenon of timing, and the cinema has nothing to do with...
What's interesting about this, you think that we've come full circle and that the new wave of films are going to be small, interpersonal, about relationships, do you?
What I feel in a nutshell, to get off Apocalypse
now, I'll come back to it, but
is that we live in a world right now that, if anything, needs a cinema that sheds light on life and on relationships with men and women and family and ideals and but in a new form and a new content. Whereas the film industry basically is such an important industry that it by nature must keep manufacturing a product, because it has to have the people go back every day like you do at a fast food thing. So they're into, and when I say the cinema, it's the whole hub of it, the criticism, the studios, everyone wants there just to be basically old content done well. And I feel suddenly, you know, there are all these young people writing scripts, hoping to be discovered to make their fortune. And I just feel that sooner or later, some, God knows, 19-year-old is going to write a script that's really about life, and that is about, that is new, because once again, it's about something real.
You think that's going to happen. I would assume that there must be 50 scripts around.
No, the young people, they're all writing scripts that's the next Sleepless in Seattle or the next film noir, or no one writes a film about what they think about their brother.
But are they doing that? That's what Marty started doing too. I mean, he went back and wrote a film, Mean Streets.
Right.
Was about just that, the kind of thing you're talking about,
right?
But
that's why it was so welcome. I mean, even then, now all the more, as we live in an age where basically each year, whether it's a sequel or not, it's basically a recycled, and the name of the game, even the critical establishment doesn't want anything really new, because then they have to say whether it's good or bad. They would rather have something. This is always what happens in art. You know, the painters back then wanted a picture that looked like a picture.
But is the piano something new?
I haven't seen the piano yet because I've been sort of away.
But my
hunch
that.
Is it's probably not.
Probably not.
Probably not new. I don't know.
Have you seen anything that represents what you're talking about that's really new? Nothing.
No. I kind of took a year off from film, from seeing films, from really everything, just since I'm 16 years old. This is the first year I took off, just to be able to look at everything with new eyes.
And so
maybe Reservoir Dogs is new. I haven't seen that. My kids tell me it is.
It is. Yeah.
You know. So, but that's what I think is going to be the next exciting,
Do you want to be part of that?
Sure, to the extent that my weird personality and abilities can be part of that. I think all the time about life and about the big picture of life, which is, you know, spirituality and philosophy and politics and what a new society could be like and how it could be beautiful, how we can retain the great traditions of the past, which is to say, you know, a book,
and at the same time
especially, have one foot in the past and have yet one foot in the future, and somehow, I mean, this is all I think about.
What have you learned? I'm going to come back to Apocalypse and Godfather, because everybody wants me to talk about that with you because it's so much a part of cinema history. But what have you learned in this year? What have those fresh eyes seen?
It's inappropriate me to try to give you a sentence.
All right, I'm not looking for a summary, but I mean, just give me some sense of what...
I basically feel that there are going to be some opportunities that happen that perhaps can give me what I'm looking for, which is once again the adventure. I think that once again, there could be live cinema, there could be live television that is writer driven, that the whole quality of writing and the thinking and content that is really the most essential part of the cinema could once again get out of this outrageous kind of what they call developmental process, and once again have authors who bring their views, which is their views of life and their views of, right, of people, to be at the center of then whatever the cinematic or television product is, and that ultimately perhaps live think about it. Everyone's talking about television and the incredible interconnectivity
and the telephone channels
cables, but yet live television, which is an art form of its own, which we demonstrated in the United States in the 50s, right, which starts with the writer and which can go out live with live performance and in a way that is less easy for the so-called corporate mind to control, because when you go out live, you're in the hands of the artist.
Right.
This to me is one of the most exciting new fields. And I say new field, knowing it's an old field, where the whole world is gonna be able to connect with some actors and some writers and some directors. And yet you don't hear a peep about this, you know, in the world. But on the other hand, think of this. I mean, we hear about what the well-worn ideas of what's wrong with the world and the destruction of the rainforests and the extraordinary problems, yet no one will ever even say what the real problem is, which is overpopulation. The problem is not that they're destroying the rainforest. The problem is that the planet was not created to house more than 4 or 5 billion people. So very often the things that are at the root and the most interesting is the thing that no one will talk about. So for me, live cinema or performance cinema could be one of the new areas for a person like myself or anyone who's serious about really interpreting life for the world, which is what art does.
Let me test this on you, and I'm not a psychiatrist, but listening to you and having read a lot about you, I see this, and that's why I was interested in what had shaped you and how you came to get involved in movies. It's an interesting combination, because I have talked to so many directors on this broadcast, and most of them, on their short list of great directors is you. At the same time, there is this question in the public arena, whatever happened to Francis Ford Coppola? How did someone who did such sort of seminal films like The Godfather, why isn't he making great films? Steven Spielberg just made Schindler's List. He's continuing to grow, let's say. We wonder if you're continuing to grow, and we wonder if the reason is you were so driven by so many passions, family, entrepreneurship, building empires and institutions, that you didn't have a whole lot of time left for doing what you really did, which is make great movies.
Well, my first response, would be, number one, my films were not greeted as great films when they came out. Even Godfather, which is the only film I ever made that had what we will call a great success, was very controversial and critically was really, at the time, it was a mixed reaction critical hit. My films are unusual. Partly because I look at art as an adventure, and I mean, what other film director, if you took his first film and his seventh film, are so dissimilar? My styles are always different. I'm very willing to go in different directions. I don't just basically make the same kind of film.
I hear you, and people can say.
So right from the beginning, in time, and I lived through it, so I know my work was always greeted. Even Godfather 2, I mean, if you remember back, the reviews and the buzz, to use a contemporary word, was that Godfather 2 was not as good as Godfather 1. Yeah. I know it because, you know, I was crushed, because I knew that if that happened and I couldn't live up to the promise of Godfather 1, which at the time I spent my time defending that I hadn't romanticized the mafia and that it had value as a piece of art. So that since in those days, the films that I made, which are today considered classics, were not considered classics. Equally so, the films that I've made more recently have the same reception.
Yeah, but that does not mean that they were as good.
But
just because they're now saying...
Did I say whether they were good? I didn't say the first ones. All I'm saying is that the judgment of these films in their time was always that Francis Coppola is promising, but the reaction is mixed. And that's the same thing that they've said about films, just to pull one out of the hat, The Cotton Club.
Right.
But look at The Cotton Club and then consider how it was received. And yourself, see what you think of the picture. Or, you know, my theory is that when a film is unusual and tries to break new ground, that when it's like a new food that you put in front of a person, I eat that, I don't like that.
Because I have no.
But 6 years later, I remember that stuff my mother used to make. Wow, I like that better than Hershey bar. So my only point is, first of all, it's not important whether a person is making great films or not. Because as we know, what really makes a great film is one thing, whether it lives.
Right.
And that can only really be judged later on. So for me...
But let me ask you, because it lives, do you think, just you, mm-hmm. that The Cotton Club is going to live like The Godfather will live? Or like Conversation? Or even Apocalypse Now, which many people think was two-thirds brilliant and...
Right. Well, all my films were considered that way. In my opinion...
Cotton Club is not in the same league, even close.
When was the last time you saw it?
Been a while.
Yeah, look at it again. The main thing is...
But I'm interested in you, because I have not one-tenth of the ability to judge a film that you do. I'm saying, do you believe The Cotton Club is in the same league with The Godfather 1, Godfather 2? Forget Godfather 3 for a second.
It's not for me to talk about my films as to what league, but I'll tell you this. Aside from the fact that many of the films I made post... my studio were made more because I had to make a film and Bob Evans said, I want to make The Cotton Club, go make it. And I made one film after another, basically on demand. I would say that the reason you make a film is a very important ingredient in what that film ultimately likes. But to shock you, I think that some of the films that I've made in this period, when you look at it in the long term, will be viewed on the same level as those earlier pictures.
And that's what I'm interested in. Name me those that you think are every bit as good and that history will be kind to.
Oh, I think Cotton Club for sure. I think Tucker for sure.
Yeah, I agree with Tucker.
I think a film that's really out there and weird and people are just starting to understand that it doesn't work like a regular movie is Dracula. When I made Godfather 2, as I said, the first thing I remember going under my bed, on the floor, under my bed, because that's what a man does, because he can't just break out crying at the reaction to Godfather 2, with things that I overheard.
You did what?
I went under the bed, in the space between the bed, just to kind of hide, because I could
hear... We're talking metaphor here, aren't we?
No, we're talking real space under the bed. Because there are very few things a man is supposedly allowed to do to express how he feels. But because I sat in a room after a screening and could hear people discussing the picture that didn't know I could hear it and heard the things they said about Godfather 2, which was...
And you just wanted to go hide, under the bed. And in fact, you did get under the bed.
I did, because I felt secure under the bed. So a filmmaker, basically... put something out there on the table and the people judge it. And usually with me, I have never had a wild hit except for the first Godfather, which was based on a wild hit of a book.
Yeah, that's right.
People were very critical.
They went to see it because they love the book.
People were very critical of that movie. Marlon Brando mumbles.
There was a great praise of his performance in Godfather 1.
Sure, and as time went by, the praise got greater and greater. To me, what can I say? I don't care. But I am saying that when you make unusual films, that you do not tend to get the praise in time that you get 5 or 10 years later. And I already hear people telling me things about movies that got that same mixed reaction. I saw that again. That was really,
saying to me in your head, that you have lived up to the expectation that you had for yourself after the start that you got?
I didn't live up to the expectation I had for myself with The Godfather or with with Apocalypse
Well,
Now.
Let me talk about Godfather for a second. I mean, I love Apocalypse Now, and I want to talk more about that, but we're off to somewhere else now. I'm told that when you delivered a rough cut to Evans at Paramount, Godfather 1, it was scheduled for later distribution. that he said, Bob Evans said, this is not there. You go back and make a better movie. Is that a true story?
Now you'll get the real truth.
Okay.
I was editing Godfather in San Francisco. Paramount was in L.A. Bob Evans told me that when you bring me the film and show me the film, if it's over an hour and 15 minutes, we're not even going to talk about it. The movie is getting brought to L.A. and you're not going to work in San Francisco.
Just for the benefit of the audience, Bob Evans is at that time head of production for Paramount.
I was told that if the picture was longer, because they did not want a long picture, if you want to retain your privacy and edit the movie in your own studio, which is partly why I'd done Godfather, was to keep being able to keep all these young film directors alive, and it was very important to me to be able to finish the film in San Francisco. I was told if I brought the film down to Paramount and it was over this length, that it was going to be edited down in LA where they could supervise it. So we made the film, we made a cut of the film. It was an hour and 45 minutes, and it was the movie. I mean, I have it on tape. Even in those days, I was editing using tape.
Yeah, you were always
said,
into the
what are we going to do? We have a movie that's an hour and 45 minutes. Evan says if it's over an hour and 15 minutes, it's going to LA. So for a week, we sat down and we cut out this scene or half of this scene, and we brought a movie down that was an hour and 15 minutes.
Right.
Evans looked at it and he says, you have destroyed the picture. You have taken all of the texture, the family stuff out of it.
Right.
He says, you're bringing it down to LA, which translates into he was bringing that film down to LA where he could kind of be all over it, no matter whether I brought it down at 115 or 145. So then we brought it down to LA, where we put back all the film that had been before we brought it down, and we made it up to 145 minutes. And he looked at it and he says, see, now it works.
Yeah.
I mean, this is what it's like in Hollywood.
This is why you wanted to create your own studio.
Of course.
It was to be able to allow artists to have freedom from that kind of mentality. And you got it, but then you had to take all these risks, and you lost it, right?
I didn't lose anything, really. I mean,
you don't have the studio.
I don't have the one in L.A., but I have the one in San Francisco.
Yeah. I mean, do you have the freedom now and the resources to make the kind of movies you want to make?
Well, that's tricky, because the kinds of movies that I really want to make cannot be easily classified by what was successful 2 years ago. So I really wonder if anyone other than Steven, can make the kind of movies they want to make, if those kind of movies are really new and that really break a lot of what the wisdom of the distribution business and the industry says. In other words, I don't think anybody can.
Yeah, you haven't seen Schindler's, right?
Not yet. No.
Yeah. He said an interesting thing. He said, if I'd made Schindler's before, I don't think I would have wanted to make a dinosaur movie.
Look, I always felt that Steven was a prodigy, and when people used to say that his subject matter was infantile or what have you, I say, hey, he's 45 years old. Every year he gets older, he's going to bring his talent to new subject and get his confidence. And, it doesn't surprise me at all that he's made a distinguished film. He's made a lot of distinguished films.
Yeah. Back to you, Godfather. Tell me in your mind what it was about. Everybody wants to talk about the mafia is an American corporation. They want to talk about the family and all of that. What was in the director's mind?
Okay, we'll change from what we were talking about, which was Apocalypse, that we kind of were halfway
exactly
there. But we'll go to The Godfather. To me, when I read the book, The Godfather, it seemed to me that, and those of you who remember the book, there was this story of a family that seemed classical, almost, kind of like a Grecian or Shakespearean. And at the same time, there was this kind of Irving Wallace novel about a woman whose vagina was too big. I mean, half the book was dedicated to a doctor who made a woman's genitalia smaller. People don't remember that now. But when I looked at the book, in fact, I didn't like the book at first because I thought it was sleazy. But this story of a man who was a king, who had three sons, and each son represented an aspect of him, and there was going to be a question of succession. That is what I saw when I looked at the film, whether it was Joseph Kennedy and his children's or someone who lived.
About a patriarch.
Yeah.
I know you hate this question, but I'll ask it anyway. Is it the film that you cherish the most?
Not at all.
It's not?
No.
What is?
You know, you asked me a lot about what I thought of my work, right. And I said more or less, I really believe that my body of work is all about on the same level. I mean, I have never, my flops, of which every director has, are probably among the more interesting flops than people have.
And did you learn from them?
Sure. Every film I make is an experiment in preparation for the next one. I never really did what it was I intended to do, which was to be really a writer of original material, original stories, original scripts, because I can, that I direct. The only ones I've ever done that's Woody Allen, and to which I take my hat off. I, being a well-trained theater director and versed in musical comedy and the feeling that I could do a comedy, I could do Shakespeare, I could do anything, that worked against me because what I really wanted to do was to write original material for the cinema and then direct it. And I only did it on two occasions, The Conversation and The Rain People, much earlier. And for that reason, I haven't lived up to my expectations. And if I am to live up my expectations in this period of my life, it would be because I do that.
Yeah. And you're a young man. It's still time to do that. I mean, my sense of you also, and I don't want to impose my projection of you onto you, but it is that, you know, you had a huge appetite. Yes, you'll give me that. And secondly, that huge appetite was directed towards creating, you know, a vehicle that could do the kinds of things without the interference.
I'm a builder.
That's exactly what
I would like to build a city. If someone said to me, what do you want to do? I would say, I want to build a new city. I want to build a new society. I mean, I'm just a builder. So whatever I'm going to get to do shy of that is going to be what I do in these next years.
And your vision is to be the vision you have is still to be the builder.
It's what I am.